Well, welcome to the battery breakout session this afternoon. I'm really happy that you can all be here. And the main part of the breakout session will take over my colleague Roman. And I will directly hand over to him for a battery simulation workflow as an example for battery application. Your own micro. Yeah, right.
Hey, thank you, Ilona. Thank you very much for the introduction. Welcome, all of you, and also all the people online for the breakout session of the this year's GeoDict Innovation Conference about battery simulations. And I just start with a short introduction of myself. My name is Roman Buchheit. I'm application engineer and business manager for batteries and fuel cells at Math2Market. And from training, I'm a material scientist. So I'm now since 2 years at Math2Market. And before I was doing experimental research, so I was working with nanoparticle layers in my PhD thesis. And I also was 1 year in experimental process development for lithium ion battery electrode fabrication in the industry at Robert Bosch. And I'm very happy to present you today this battery simulation breakout session. This is the agenda for today's breakout session. I want to start in the first part about the latest features and the greatest features we have for battery simulations with GeoDict. And so it's like kind of an overview about the most important features and about the new features we have. And then I want to present a typical workflow, how you can perform a battery simulation, what different models there are. And then I want to, in the second part, I want to show you the different models that you can use for the battery simulation, and also a showcase about the validation of a half cell with a graphite electrode, how you can do this. And then the last part will be for question and answers. Okay, so first, motivation. Why are we working on electrochemistry? Why are we working on electrochemical energy storage? And here you see the primary energy consumption in Germany, and also how it's predicted to change until 2050. And you all know we want to make this transition away from fossil fuels to renewable energy. And at the moment, we still have quite a large share of the primary energy usage in Germany from fossil fuels, but this should be reduced and replaced by renewable energy sources. This can be wind or solar energy. And then you need to store this renewable energy somehow. And in applications such as mobility, you need batteries for this. And this is why batteries are a very important device to make this transition to happen. And this is just a graph I found about the battery market worldwide. And we are now here in 2024. And it's predicted that until 2030, the battery market will double. There are many different battery cells in the market. Like there are consumer batteries, like these primary cells or nickel metal hydride cells that are rechargeable. Maybe you know these from home use. Then, of course, still a big share is the lead acid battery that is used in cars. And that is here, this dark dark color in the columns. So it's still quite a big share of the global battery market because there are so many cars worldwide. So, but the problem is it's very heavy and the energy density is not so large. And for new applications like electrical battery vehicles, the lithium ion battery is the most important technique because it has the highest energy density. And this is this blue part here of the column, and you see this is strongly increasing. So the lithium ion battery is kind of the most important battery technology these days, and this is why I want to focus on the lithium-ion battery in the following talk. And also these lithium-ion batteries can have many different applications, and depending on the application, you need another kind of battery. So this is an example for a very large battery. It's like a size of a container, and this is used to make a grid stabilization. So it's next to a wind park, for example. When there's a lot of wind blowing, then this giant battery is charged. And when there's a peak demand, for example, in the morning, all people get up and want to switch on the coffee machine or so, then it's discharged. And here, in this application, you aim for a battery that can store a high amount of energy, and it should also be low cost. And when you have very high size of the battery, there should be also high safety for the battery. Then a kind of medium-sized battery would be in electric cars. Here, you also want to aim for safety. Maybe it's more mechanical stress here. When you have an accident, you also want that the battery is safe. But what is maybe important here is you want to charge it fast, because if you have a long trip, you don't want to wait for several hours until the battery is charged again. And that is kind of a performance parameter maybe for electrical car batteries. And then this is maybe the area where we in each day life have most contact with batteries is for consumer electronics. There you want also high energy. You want that your phone can last whole day and that you can use your computer for several hours. And these batteries are doing a lot of cycles, because when you use your phone, it's like a full cycle each day. You fully charge and discharge it. And you want to use your device for several years, and then you want a life cycle stability. So all these different applications need other battery performance indices. And in classical battery design, you can just vary all these parameters in experiments. So you can vary the chemistry of the materials that you use in the battery. You can vary the thickness of the electrodes, the porosity, the grain sizes, and so on. And you always want to achieve with these different modifications to have to reach a goal in your material design. Like you want to save the cost, because the active materials in the battery are very expensive. You want to make best use of it. So they should be all used when you have the final battery, and there should not be unused material inside the battery that does not contribute to the capacity. Then you want to switch between high power application or high energy application, and you want to improve the lifetime. And kind of classical material design is that you do trial and error of all the different parameters you have. But because there are so many parameters that you can modify in the battery, you cannot test all the different parameters, and it will be quite slow and also a lot of work to get the experimental results, because battery research you have to do without air, so you need a glove box maybe, and it's not easy experiments when you do it. And here's where we think that digital material design can be really helpful to make this battery material development faster and also more cost efficient. Because in the digital design, you can have a digital model of your battery electrode and then vary parameters there and cover a much larger parameter space than when you only have experiments. And for example, this is a quote from one of our customers, Mr. Pohl from the Cellforce group. And they say they are using GeoDict as a key software for their digital development for designing battery materials. And yeah, I will show you how you can also do it in the following talk. Yeah. This is maybe an image how you can imagine an electrode in a battery. It's a bit like a very complicated traffic system in a big city. It's a bit similar to what Adrian showed this morning in his talk. the battery electrode has many different components. And in each component, there's a different species that has to be transported. Like you have in the electrolyte phase, lithium ions that you want to transport. Then also in the active material, the lithium ions have to diffuse. And then you need electrons to be transported in the structure. This is mainly in the binder in carbon black. And like very similar to such a highway in a city, you don't want to have any bottlenecks. So when the highway is bad designed, then you get a traffic jam. And the same would be in the battery. If one of these components is not like adjusted to your use case of the battery, then it won't work well. And this is how you can influence the performance of the battery by designing the microstructure. Okay, maybe most of you are familiar on how a lithium-ion battery works, but just as a short repetition, I want to show you in this scheme. So you have two different electrodes, a cathode and an anode. Both have an active material, and these active materials are making the electrochemical reaction. Lithium ions are either intercalated or deintercalated into the material, and then you can store or release energy. And in between the two electrodes, you have a porous separator material. This separator only lets the lithium ion pass, but the electrons have to go all the way outside through the external circuit. In this scheme here, you see the charging process. So the lithium ions in this process move from the cathode to the anode, and you apply an external voltage source to charge the battery. And now you can think about how can I improve the microstructure to get a better capacity, for example, in the battery. And this is an example of a cathode electrode, like an NMC electrode. And you can ask yourself, how does the performance of the battery change when I modify the binder content? And there's actually two things that will happen when you increase the binder. It's good for your electrical conductivity. It will go up when you increase the binder content, because this carbon binder network is a good electron conductor. But on the same at the same time, you decrease the porosity of the electrode, and the pores are important for the lithium ion transport. So when you have a large binder content, this diffusion in the electrolyte will go down. And the question is, how can I find a good trade-off here? And of course, you could now perform many experiments and test it, but this will need several weeks in the lab to make such a study. And what you could also do is you can use digital material design with GeoDict, and then just make a charging simulation here with a charge rate of 2C. And see how is the accessible capacity when I have a cutoff voltage of 4.2 volts. And then you find kind of the sweet spot, so the binder content that is optimal. And here at this position, you get a 0.5 increase of the cell capacity just by adjusting this. And when you have a large factory running with creating electrical cars like Tesla's Gigafactory, they build 100,000 cars a year. They need 100 million battery cells to do that. And with an increase of the capacity by 0.5%, they need 450,000 cells less a year. So that can save them almost $7 million. So it's like really something that pays off when you look into these details in your battery. Yeah, this is another example. It's designing an anode this time. So it's an electrode with graphite. And the aim was to improve the microstructure that you get less lithium plating in the electrode. Lithium plating is a degradation mechanism that can also be dangerous, because in the worst case, you get a lithium dendrite that penetrates the separator or something. And so the original battery had a kind of irregular grain orientation, an effective diffusivity of 21%. And with the optimized microstructure, you find that with oriented grains in the microstructure, you get a higher diffusivity, and the lithium plating at high C rate of 3C only starts at 89% state of charge. So that's another possibility how digital material development helps you. And the question is now, how is the workflow to do such a digital material design? And let me just guide you through the typical workflow that you would do when you do a material design with GeoDict. So the first step is you need a digital model of your microstructure. We have seen already this morning some talks about importing grayscale scans. And this is what how the workflow starts. So when you import the grayscale images, you either have CT images or you have FIB-SEM images, and you need to segment this. And you can do it by grayscale values only, but you can also do the AI segmentation. Then you need to label your images to train the AI to do the segmentation correctly. And here we have quite a big improvement. Oops. There should be a video playing, sorry. Cannot play. Okay. Doesn't work, unfortunately. But we have a magic brush feature now. This means that GeoDict helps you now to label your grayscale images faster. And unfortunately, the video doesn't work, but you can try it yourself or just ask us if you want to know more about it. There will also be some talks about segmentation, I think, tomorrow that will focus on this. And then another new feature for importing grayscale images is that you can now use multiple image stacks. For example, here is the same FIB-SEM scan, one time with the in-lens detector and with a through-lens detector. And with each detector, you can see different details in your structure. Like maybe one of the detectors is good to separate active material from the binder and the pore space, but the other detector is maybe good to distinguish between two different active materials that you have. And this is new now in the GeoDict 2024 that you can use multiple image stacks. Then you can also use the multi-channel import to consider the orientation of your grains that you import. Maybe you have EBSD data, so electron scattering data, and you can use this information also to import the grain orientation in your digital model. And some of the material parameters are direction dependent, for example, the diffusion or so. And if you want to consider this, you can use this multi-channel import. Then another new feature we have, it's not always so easy to have a 3D scan. Of course, it's nice when you have it, but it's also expensive and not always possible to make a full 3D scan. And you might only have a 2D scan of your structure. And here we have a new geo app in GeoDict that you can create for a isotopic material, a three-dimensional structure out of a 2D image. So you only have one 2D SEM image. You segment this image, and then the 2D to 3D geo app will create you a three-dimensional digital twin out of this 2D image. And it's something you can try out. Then after this first step, the next point would be analyzing and validating the data that you have on your three-dimensional model. And for analyzing battery structures, there are a lot of different things that you can think about. Of course, the pore space is important. So you can use GeoDict to determine the porosity with different methods. There's granulometry and porosimetry that you can do. You can check the pore size distributions, the grain size distributions, surface areas, and interface areas can be analyzed. And you can characterize transport parameters like the conductivity of your electrode, the diffusivity of the electrode. And when you perform electrochemical simulation, you can also determine local lithium concentrations. So this is something I will show later. So there's a lot of possibilities to characterize your electrodes. And it's very easy once you have a three-dimensional model in GeoDict to do all this. But with experiments, it's not always so easy. For example, for measuring the pores with experiments, you need mercury porosimetry, and then you only measure the pore throats and not like the total geometry of the pores. And this is something where GeoDict can help you to make this more accurate and also faster. Okay, and the point is, it's nice when you have a scan of an electrode that you fabricated in the lab, but you cannot always test any electrode with a 3D scan. So then your boss might say, okay, you waste too much of your working time to make scans of your electrodes, and that's too expensive. But then you can say, yeah, that's not a problem. GeoDict has also structure generators. So I also can make something that we call a statistical twin. And the statistical twin is kind of a artificially created structure that is different from the scan, but it has the same statistical properties. So it behaves, it has the same properties like the electrode you scanned. And here you see an example for a graphite electrode. There was a CT scan, and with GeoDict you can determine the diffusivity, tortuosity 1.8, and the grain diameter. And with the structure generators of GeoDict, you can create a digitally created graphite electrode structure, and it has just the same properties like this CT scan. And yeah, once you know how you create it, then you can create this structure very fast. And also you can say, maybe I want to vary some of the parameters like the porosity, or I want to vary the grain sizes. And yeah, that's very a very interesting approach. And once you vary these parameters, you come into the last part of the design of the material development workflow, because now you can start to actually design a new microstructure that you have not even fabricated yet, because you can test different properties, different parameters, and predict how this structure would behave. And for this, we have geo-apps inside of GeoDict. And with just one click, you can create an electrode structure like anode structures here on the top, or cathode structures here on the bottom. And for example, the parameter that was varied here is the area loading for the electrode. It has always the same thickness, but a different porosity. So a high area loading would rather be for high energy electrode. And when you have a lower area loading, then you have larger pore space that is maybe more for high performance, like high power electrode. And you can now evaluate how these different parameters influence the performance of your battery and perform parameter studies. So that is the idea of this digital twin. Okay, yeah, then when you have now the new material, you want also to see how does it perform when I do an electrochemical charging or discharging simulation. And here we have actually different models. I will explain it later in more detail. But since GeoDict 20, or something we already have since quite a long time, is you have your microstructure, and then on this microstructure you do electrochemical simulation. For example, one of the solvers we have that does this is the best microsolver. And you get a lot of details from this, but the downside is that the computation runtime and the needed memory for this example was like 9 hours or 65 gigabytes. So when you do a lot of simulations, because you do parameter studies, you maybe don't want to wait so long until you have the result for each parameter you are testing. And for this, we have now a homogenized model, and this is using the best mesosolver. And with that model, you can have a much shorter runtime, only 20 minutes, and much less memory also that is used. And you see that the cell potential curve of the two different solvers is quite similar. So yeah, that will be a part of the talk later. How can I choose in what solver or what model I use in what case? And the good thing is, for this homogenized model, you need effective properties of your electrode. And it's not so easy to get these effective properties, but GeoDict helps you also to get the effective parameters for the homogenized model, because it's automatically calculating it from the microstructure directly. So even when you have some Newman model that you have adjusted in-house with some special equations or so, and you wonder, how can I get the effective parameters, you can use GeoDict for this. Then something that is recently a lot worked on are solid-state batteries. And these have this the special thing in solid-state batteries is that all the materials are solid. And like in a conventional battery, you have a liquid electrolyte. But in the solid-state batteries, also the electrolyte is a solid material. And this brings some benefits. For example, you can have higher safety, because this liquid electrolyte can burn if there's some problem with the battery, like overcharging or accident or short circuit or something. And you can also have a higher energy density, because you possibly can use metallic lithium anode, because here the solid electrolyte can prevent that dendrites of lithium are penetrating a separator, and then you get a short circuit. So with a solid electrolyte, you can prevent this and get a higher energy density. And you can also simulate such solid state batteries with GeoDict. We have a tutorial on our YouTube page how you can set up a structure like this and run a simulation. And we also have now project started just last year. It's called Delphine, and we are working together with universities in Ulm and Gießen, and they want to measure the material properties of the solid state battery. They want to perform experiments, and we want to adapt GeoDict to get also the battery simulation optimized for such structures. And yeah, there was already some improvements in the solver made when you have the solid state batteries, but we want to continue to work on this. So stay tuned, there will be for sure news in this area. Okay, and now to the end of this section, just let me come to two important parameters for a good battery. One is you want to have control about the degradation in your battery cells, because your customers expect a lifetime of the battery. You maybe want to guarantee a lifetime of the battery. And we all know how annoying it is when your phone is some years old and then the battery doesn't last whole day. So that is not nice. And another important thing is you want to grant the safety of your batteries. Like this is kind of the worst case, that you get a short circuit, maybe due to lithium plating, and then the battery will be on fire. And you don't want this. So you want to design the battery to reduce the risk of such accidents. And this is also where GeoDict can help you. Not long lasting battery would be not very feasible, like when you only can charge the car 500 times, it's not good. And what actually is damaging the battery when you charge it, and one of the degradation mechanisms is mechanical degradation inside of the battery electrode. Because as I said before, at each charging, you are moving the lithium ions from one electrode to the other electrode, and the ions have to enter the material and leave the material again. And it's a bit like when you have a car and you park into a car park, and you do this very often, then at some point you maybe get some damage in the car because you bump somewhere, and then you have a scratch or like damage on the car. And when you go even faster with your car, or the parking space is very small, then the risk of this is higher. And the same is with the battery. So when you do a lot of these charging cycles, then at some point you might get cracks and damage inside of your microstructure of the battery, and then the capacity starts to fade. But with GeoDict, what you can do now is you can perform electrochemical and mechanical coupled simulation. So you perform first electrochemical simulation, then you see how do the lithium concentrations change locally. And then you can, in a second step, calculate how are the volume changes due to this lithiation, for example, of the active material, where the material will expand a bit. And this expansion due to lithium intercalation will cause stresses in the structure. And you can calculate these stresses and strains and even provide a failure model as a mechanical model. Then you see where do I have damage in the material. And then you can try to optimize the structure that these mechanical stress is reduced. Something that is new is also that we now are working on releasing contacts. So when you have delithiation of ions, then the material shrinks. And then contacts that were forming during expansion have to be released again. And this is something we are currently working on. We got asked quite from different clients for this feature. And we hope that it will be ready soon for the clients also. Okay, then about this lithium plating, which I have already mentioned before. So what is the problem here? The problem is when you have, for example, fast charging, or you do charging at low temperature, then the overpotentials at the anode can be such that you have metallic lithium plated on the active material. And this metallic lithium can then form dendrites that penetrate the separator, and then you have a short circuit inside of your battery. You have a high current, you have a lot of heat, and then maybe you get, in the worst case, you get a fire. And GeoDict can help you to predict the risk of lithium plating with a certain microstructure and a certain operation condition. Like, for example, here you have a 3C charging rate for NMC graphite battery, and then you can visualize the potential versus lithium on this microstructure, and you see that close to the separator, the potential versus lithium is below zero, So this means that thermodynamically, here lithium plating could occur. And then you can maybe see, can I optimize the microstructure to reduce this risk somehow? Yeah, and one of the possibilities to reduce overpotentials and also lithium plating is applying charging cycles that are kind of a smart charging cycle. So you not only use simply a high current to charge your battery fast, but you also have relaxation steps during the charging. And these relaxation steps allow that the lithium ion concentration is equilibrating inside of the cell, and overpotentials will be reduced. And then you might be able to charge your battery fast and safe at the same time. And we now have these relaxation steps also implemented into GeoDict. So when you are using in charging profiles in GeoDict 2024, you can also set up relaxation steps. And here you see, for example, a two-step charging profile. So here, first with a constant current with 2C, you see the cell potential is increasing. And then here, the relaxation is starting. And now the cell potential drops to the equilibrium potential. This is this dashed line. And during the relaxation, the concentration gradients in the electrode, so the example here is the NMC LCO electrode, will equilibrate. And you can visualize, for example, the currents inside of the electrolyte during this relaxation. Yeah, so you see there's a lot of things you can do for batteries in with GeoDict. And we have a lot of customers that are using GeoDict. There are customers from the automotive industry here, then the cell manufacturers. And of course, also many academic customers like Adrian, for example, with his talk this morning, showing some of the battery research they do with GeoDict. And so maybe you are also one of these satisfied customers, or you want to become one of them. And this graph here just shows the seven biggest cell producers of battery cells in 2020. And we are very proud that five of these seven big cell producers are using GeoDict. So they really see the benefit of the digital material design to get faster results and improving the batteries. Okay, yeah, and this was already the first part. I hope you are now also, you understand what are the possibilities you have, and that this can be really useful to get better batteries. And now in the next part, I want to show you what is kind of the workflow to do such a battery development process. I thought I'd make the questions in the very end. Then, okay. Or maybe we can make some questions before the break. That could be something. Yeah. So I just want to go on, or like to repeat a bit. So what's the idea here? We make digital material design because we want to address all these questions we have while designing the next generation battery. And we use digital model to make parameter studies and to understand what can be improvements in the microstructure to reach the goals that we have for our application. And then you can have a better use also for your experimental capabilities, because you can only focus on the very interesting candidates that you find with the digital design. And then you don't waste so much resources with trial and error experiments that are not very efficient. And the message from our side, when you're doing such a digital material design process, is always use the adequate model for the question you have, or you could also say, don't crack a nut with a sledgehammer. And then you might wonder, okay, what do the people mean at math to market when they say different models? And here I want to use this image from a locomotive model, because maybe it's a bit more easy to understand. So when you have a locomotive model, you can have many different models to represent a real locomotive. And one of the models could be like this quite simple wooden locomotive, and you see already, okay, this is the locomotive, and it has all the important parts of a locomotive. I can see everything. I can see it has four wheels. I can even move it, and it's already a working model, but it's also a simple model. And here on this side, you have this Märklin locomotive, and this is much more complicated. You have a lot of details there, a lot of moving parts when the locomotive is running. But you also see much more than when you only look at this wooden locomotive, but both are a working model for a locomotive. And then you could also have a model for just the steam engine. So that's the part that is actually giving the power for the locomotive. And maybe you only want to see a model of this one. So, and it's very similar with models that you can use for batteries. You can also have different focus of the model. You can have different level of detail, and each of these models have a different use case. And this is what I want to show in the following. Okay, just a short repetition about the design process. So first step is you need a microstructure to apply the model on, and it can either be imported or generated with the structure generators. And yeah, this is an example for importing a FIB-SEM image. We have already seen some of these pictures in the morning session. This is once again cathode structure with a high resolution, like 30 nanometer voxel size. And in this length scale, you can even see the binder and the pores inside the binder. And then you can use the AI segmentation to create this highly resolved model of the cathode that you fabricated before in the lab inside of GeoDict. And then on the other hand, we have the structure generators, like I have shown before, where you can just with one click create an electrode structure and, for example, vary area loading, pore size, grain size, and so on. So now we have the microstructure, and now you can think on what do I want to model on this microstructure. And the first question you have, maybe when you when we come back to the locomotive, is you want to know more about the steam engine. So the steam engine is kind of the heart of the locomotive. It's creating the power that the locomotive can move. And if you would be interested in that, then you would use a model just for the steam engine. So just looking at a part of the locomotive. And the analog for a battery model would be that you are interested in isolated transport phenomena, like you want to look at the ion diffusion, or you want to look at the electron conduction inside of the electrode. And just as you could see here from this, from the steam engine, how much power the locomotive has to move, you can get by looking on these properties in the battery, how is the effective transport parameters of my battery electrode. And so here are all the or some examples for the analysis of the microstructure that you can do. So this is an example for analyzing the pores with granulometry. And the granulometry analysis will fit spheres inside of your pore space. And for each pore, give you the equivalent diameter of the pore. And you can visualize it here with this color code. So the large pores are the red color. Small pores have this blue color, though that is here in the areas where you have a low cross-section area between two different active materials. You can also visualize the pore size distribution in a graph. And yeah, so you can quite fast analyze how are the pore characteristics, for example, of my electrode. Then you can also use porosimetry analysis. This is not using a different approach. So it's more similar like an experiment where you do mercury intrusion, because here you are detecting the pore throats, so kind of the opening of a pore. And once again, you can visualize it. So large pore throats will be in red. So for example, here in this area, and small pore sizes have blue color. And you see that here on the same structure, this pore size distribution looks different just by changing the methods. The good thing is that you can use various methods. Maybe you want to combine the results to learn most about the properties. You can also analyze how is the shape, like do I have some different lengths in one direction, for example. And then you can analyze how is the ion transport inside of this pore phase. Like here you see the diffusion flux inside of the pores in Z direction. And from this diffusion simulation, you would get the effective diffusion. You would get the tortuosity for the ion transport. And all this is already helpful to understand. Is my electrode performing well? For example, when the diffusion is very bad, then you know that this electrode might not be very helpful if I aim for a high power application where I want to have fast charging, for example. Then another thing is the electron transport, because you also need electrons to be moving inside of the microstructure. And for that, you can perform conduction simulation. And this will give you the effective conductivity of the electrode. So when you look on the electrons are conducted in the carbon binder phase. And in the active material and for cathode materials, the conductivity is not so high, but in anode materials like graphite, they have high conductivity. So they are usually conduction is not such a problem. Okay, yeah, and this is already the part I want to end. So we can have already some questions. And yeah, next I want to talk about the different electrochemical models. So for the electrochemical charging and discharging experiments. And this is interesting, but also a bit complicated. And then it's maybe good that we are all a bit refreshed now after the break to when we talk about this. And yeah, I just want to come back to the images we had already seen before, like the different models. And now in the next part, we want to see the electrochemical performance of the battery. And this is the same like when you look on the complete locomotive that is actually moving. The same is when you look on an electrochemical simulation of the battery, then you have all the different phenomena at the same time. You have the ion transport, you have the electron transport, you have concentration changes. And one of the models that you can use is a homogenized model. So this is also called pseudo-2D Newman model in the literature. And the advantage of this model, I can already say now as a teaser, is that you have fast computation times. So this is the model that is interesting when you want to test a lot of different parameters. And how this works, I will show you now in the following. Okay, so I have already talked a lot that the first step is that you import the microstructure of your battery inside of GeoDict, or that you generate the microstructure of the battery inside of GeoDict. And here in this fully resolved microstructure, each voxel represents one part of the battery, like active material, carbon binder domain, separator, pore filled with electrolyte. And the idea now for the homogenized model is that you simplify this complicated microstructure with the full resolution to a homogenized microstructure. And this homogenized microstructure only consists of a one-dimensional line of voxels. And the idea is that the ion transport and the electron transport and the battery is basically in one dimension, like in this charging direction. And then you can just represent this with this assumption in the one-dimensional line of voxels representing current collector here in gray, then the anode in blue, the separator in green, and in light green, the cathode. And if you look on such a voxel of anode or cathode, the voxel is now representing the porous electrodes. So you have electrolyte fraction in the porous voxel, and you also have the active materials. And the active materials now have a representative particle for each different active material. And also the porous electrode voxel has the effective properties of the electrode, like the effective diffusivity, the effective conductivity, the volume fractions. And then you have kind of a representative representation of the total electrode in each of these porous electrode boxes. And then for the active materials, you only look on one radial representative particle where you can calculate the diffusion. Okay, and this is maybe now a bit complicated, a lot of equations, but then you maybe also see the nice work that our developers and also the developers in ITWM are doing, like managing all this complicated mathematics when they work with the model, because you have a lot of different physical phenomena going on that are represented in the equations of the model. You have concentration gradients that form, and you have conduction of electrons and ions that are considered with Ohm's law. So this is this part here at the bottom. And you have an exchange of ions between the active material and the electrolyte. And this is described with exchange current density. So this is this I, B, V. This is the Butler-Volmer current. So that is the exchange current of the lithium ions between the active materials and the electrolyte phase. And all this is now solved in 1D dimension, like as I said. And in the homogenized model, you just have a one-dimensional line of voxels. And then because of this simplification that you reduce it to one dimension, then this equation is solved much faster than when you look on the fully resolved model. And so this is first part of the model for the electron and ion transport inside of the battery in this charging direction. And the second part is the concentration gradient that still forms in active material particles when you have intercalation or deintercalation of lithium ions. So here you see, for example, that the active material is lithiated. This means lithium is coming from the interface to the electrolyte inside of the particle. And then the ions have to migrate to the center of the active material particle. And this is due to diffusion inside of the particle. And yeah, this diffusion is usually on a time scale when you have like a common common charging rate that it's like creating a concentration gradient with a certain amount inside of the particle. And to know about this concentration gradient and also how the local concentration on the surface of the particle is, you need to solve the diffusion equation. So this is here, this equation. And this is done now because we have a representative spherical particle for each active material. We only need to solve this in for in the radial direction, so also only solve it in one dimension. And this is the second dimension of the model, so this is why it's called pseudo-2D model. And yeah, so with this part of the model, with the representative particles, we know then the concentration gradient and the diffusion inside of the active materials. And with the other part of the model, with the porous electrode voxels representing all the effective parameters of the electrode, we can simulate the ion and electron transport in the during the charging in the charging direction. And yeah, for the representative electrode boxes, you need all this effective diffusion, the effective conductivity for ions, for electrons, and all this is calculated by GeoDict from the fully resolved structure automatically. So you get all the effective properties that you need for a homogenized model directly from GeoDict. And yeah, I already showed it before. The benefit is then when you use the homogenized model with the best mesosolver with this structure here, with this example, then the calculation only needed 20 minutes for the whole charging simulation from 20% state of charge to 70% state of charge. Was only 2.3 gigabyte of memory needed. And yeah, you can even get all the effective parameters that were calculated for the homogenized model in the result report. So if there are like people who are interested that they also want to simulate a very special battery, like was before the question with the calcium ion battery, and they have a model and they need these effective properties, then they can get the effective properties with this yeah, with this function of GeoDict. And yeah, because it's so fast, you can then on each variation of your battery microstructure perform a charging simulation with a homogenized model, and then after a very short computation time you get the charging curve. And just to remind you again, what's the idea of the homogenized model? So just as with the model for a train, when you have this Märklin train, then you can have a very detailed model of the train. You see how the wheels move and so on, how the different parts of the locomotive are moving. But then you also have a kind of complex model. But you see the detailed functionality of the locomotive. And the fully resolved model in GeoDict is also useful to get detailed information about your battery when you have the electrochemical cycling. Because, for example, you can get information about the local ion concentrations. And this is needed, for example, for the mechanical stress and strain simulations that I showed before. And yeah, you can get information on the potential versus lithium that can indicate the lithium plating and so on. And yeah, so I want now to show you how the idea is for this fully resolved model. So first, just once again, remember the lithium ions move from one electrode to the other in between the separator. And in the active material, the lithium ions have counter electrons to compensate the charge of the lithium ions. So the electrons have also to move from the current collectors on the outside to the active material where the lithium is intercalating or deintercalating. And the main physical principles that are used in the fully resolved model, there is a conservation of mass for the lithium atoms and conservation of charge. And in the fully resolved model, we directly simulate all the different transport processes and lithium ion exchange on the fully resolved microstructure that we imported or generated in GeoDict. However, the voxel length is in the nanometer to micrometer range, so we are clearly above the scale where you could see the effect of a single ion or a single electron. This is why, for example, not single ions are considered, but concentration changes between voxels. And yeah, we just consider the distribution of lithium concentrations and of potentials for electrons and for the ions in the model. Yeah, and yeah, you have basically two different currents. You have the electron current and you have the ionic current. And the electron current will be in the current collector, the carbon binder domain and in the active material, and the ionic current is in the separator and in the electrolyte phase. And yeah, these two currents are going in different directions. Like in this example, the ionic current is going from the cathode to the anode because we are charging the battery, but the electron current is going to the current collector and then from the current collector to inside the anode. Yeah. Okay, and now let's just look at each part of the battery one after the other. So first question is, what is happening in the electrolyte? And there are actually two different reasons for ions to move in the electrolyte. One is differences in potential, and this will cause conduction of lithium ions. And of course, there are lithium ions in the electrolyte, but also anions, for example, in a common liquid electrolyte. This is phosphor fluorate or PF6. I don't know the English word actually. And these anions can also move. And the ratio between the current between the lithium ions, lithium cations, and the negatively charged anions, this is described by the transference number. This is a property of the electrolyte. And this transference number is one of the parameters that you provide for your electrolyte in the model. And yeah, so you see that some. With time, when you have this electron ion conduction, yeah, then with time you also get a concentration gradient. For example, here you see this. You have the lithiation of the active material, so the lithium ions move towards the active material, but then you get in a region depletion of lithium ions. And then you have a concentration gradient. Like in this area, you have then a higher local lithium concentration. It's visualized now with a lot of lithium ions that are drawn here. And in this area, you have a low lithium concentration. And then the diffusion will be such to equilibrate this concentration gradient. And yeah, for example, when you do the relaxation measurement, then actually an ionic current will go from this area to this area until you have equal concentration all over the electrolyte space. Then the relaxation is finished. Yeah, and all this is calculated in the model. And this is basically the processes in the electrolyte. Then in the active material, you have the lithium ions during lithiation coming from the electrolyte inside of the active material. And to counter the positive charge of the lithium ion, you need an electron. And the electron is originating from the current collector through the electron conductive network until this interface. And then it can be kind of, you can imagine it's then close to the lithium ion and inside of the active material. There is no current anymore due to ion movement because the ion has a counter electron, but you still have a concentration gradient in the lithium concentration, because here during lithiation, all the ions come from the interface. Then you have here a high concentration, and at the center of the active material, this interface is far away, and then the lithium ions have to migrate to the center of the active material particle. And the driving force for this is the diffusion. So then you solve the diffusion equation. But here now, really, for each active material particle with the maybe quite complicated shape that the particle has, maybe it is not spherical, but more ellipsoid and so on. And yeah, so the model will solve all these diffusion fluxes inside of the active material, no matter how complicated the grain shape is. Okay, and then we are almost done with the main parts. Like, the missing part is this ion exchange between the electrolyte and the active material. And this is in the model, it's described by the Butler-Volmer equation. It's this equation here in the form of the Butler-Volmer equation we are using in the GeoDict model. And you see you need the concentrations of the active material at the interface, that is Cs. And you need the concentration of the electrolyte at the interface, that is Ce. And you also the equilibrium potential of the active material is playing a role. And then the last important parameter here is this Butler-Volmer rate constant. So this is kind of describing the kinetics of this ion exchange. And we will see later that this is a very special parameter because it's a parameter you cannot measure easily in the laboratory. But it has actually a quite strong influence how the cell potential looks like. And I will come later back to this parameter when we talk about the validation of an electrochemical simulation. And yeah, so you see all the this you see this complicated equations and so on. And if you have want to know more about it, I can only recommend that you can have a look in the GeoDict user guide. There we described everything about the different processes, and there are also literature references if you are interested, where you can read more about the model. But yeah, this is in general the idea of this fully resolved model. And just to wrap this up, I just want to show them specialities with the binder, for example. This is different possibilities how you can model it inside a GeoDict simulation. So you can set a porous binder, and the idea with the porous binder is that the binder has below the voxel resolution not resolved porosity. And in the pore fraction of the porous binder, you have electrolyte filling the pores. This means that in the porous part of porous binder, electrons can be transported. And then, for example, also intercalate to the active material. And in the solid part of the porous binder, the electrons are conducted. Then there's also a possibility that you model the binder without an porosity, and then in the model, the binder is only considered as an electron conductor in the solid part of the binder, and there is no electrolyte inside of the binder, so then there can also be no lithium intercalation between binder and active material. Only between electrolyte and active material you can have an intercalation of ions. So you need to take this in account when you set up your experiment. So mostly you have enough interface between electrolyte and active material, but when you have maybe a coated particle and all of the active material is coated with binder, and then you set the simulation that it's non-porous binder, then you just can't charge your battery because there is no ion, no ions can move through the non-porous binder phase. Then if you want to have a more detailed simulation, you can also provide concentration-dependent material parameters. The parameters of the electrolyte can be depending on the concentration, the diffusion, for example, the transference number, the ionic conductivity, but also the properties of the active material, like the diffusivity of the ions or the conductivity for electrons can depend on the ion concentration. And you can set up concentration-dependent parameters. So in GeoDict 2023, we already had it for the electrolyte. And now in GeoDict 2024, you can also use it for the active material. I will also show something about this later. And then the last part is the temperature in the validation. The material parameters can also depend on the temperature. For example, especially this Butler-Fulmer rate constant is depending on the temperature. That's one of the main reasons why, for example, the electric car in winter has a lower range, because then this kinetics for the ion exchange are also a bit hindered from the low temperature. You have a lower Butler-Fulmer rate constant, a lower diffusion constant, and then you get larger over potentials. So this means you have to remember that you need to provide the material parameters at the temperature you want to simulate. And to illustrate this, I have this slide here. So maybe first step, you do the simulation at room temperature. You have also measured all your material parameters at room temperature, so everything is fine. But now you might think, okay, I have now a battery that was getting warm, maybe during fast charging or during using the battery, and it's now at 60 degrees. And I want to simulate how's the cell potential at this elevated temperature. And you can set the temperature in the battery dict interface, but then you have to think that you need to provide the material parameters also fitting to this temperature. Like when you have 60 degrees set for the simulated temperature, then you need to provide the parameters of the electrolyte, of the graphite, and of the NMC that were also measured at this elevated temperature of 60 degrees. And so now I want to show you an example what you can do with the fully resolved model. So let's imagine we have such a battery. This is an NMC cathode, a graphite anode. And the battery should be charged at fast charging. So we have a C rate of 3C. This means in 20 minutes, you charge it from 0% to 100%. And then you see from the simulation, you have an equilibrium potential of your cell, and you have the actual cell potential during charging. And between the equilibrium potential and the cell potential during charging, you have this difference. And this difference is the so-called overpotential. And this difference here in energy will be dissipated to heat. And now you wonder, okay, how or where are the heat sources in my battery? And here the fully resolved model can help you to answer that question, because the nice thing about the simulation is you can now see all the contributions to your overpotential. So when I was doing the experimental battery research, I could just measure the cell potential, I can measure the equilibrium potential, I can calculate the overpotential, but I don't know where does this overpotential come from. And now here with the simulation, you see all the different contributions to the overpotential, and the largest one is here the blue dotted line. This is the kinetic overpotential on the cathode side, so the ion exchange between the cathode active material and the electrolyte. And sorry, you can then visualize the kinetic overpotential on the cathode active material, and then you see here high overpotentials in red, that this is especially at the large NMC grains. The second largest contribution in this simulation to the overpotential was the kinetic overpotential in the anode, that's the red dotted line. And you can also visualize this overpotential on the anode active material. And then you see, okay, this is highest on the in the area close to the separator. And the third largest contribution here is this blue dashed line, and that's the diffusion in the cathode active material, so the ion diffusion inside of the NMC. And you can visualize, for example, the diffusion flux in the NMC, and then you see, okay, the large grains have the largest diffusion flux. And when you see this, you might now wonder, how can I reduce the overpotentials and then also the heat production during charging? And one possibility that you could think of after seeing these results is you could try to reduce the active material particle size, because then you have a larger interfacial area and then possibly lower overpotentials at the for the ion exchange. And also you have smaller concentration gradient in the NMC, so smaller concentration, smaller diffusive overpotential. So that was one example what you can do with the fully resolved model. Another example is tracking down bottlenecks in the performance of an electrode. So this is the scan of a NMC electrode, and then once again you can perform a half cell simulation, so the NMC cycled against a lithium reservoir. Then you see all the different overpotentials, and you can visualize the different effects. For example, here, this is the ion flux inside of the active materials due to ion diffusion. And you see here that at the interface, this is largest, and you have kind of lateral distribution because the NMC particles are more or less spherical in the shape. So the ions diffuse from the outer side to the inside of the particles. And as larger the particle is, as more ion flux you have, because concentration gradient is larger. And you can also look on how's the ion movement in the electrolyte phase and also in the porous binder. And here you can see that the largest ionic current in the electrolyte is close to the separator. This is on this side. And close to the current collector, you have rather low ionic currents. And when you have low interfacial area, like here in between of these active material particles, you have locally a higher current, or also here in this crack of the NMC, you have locally a very high ionic count. So this helps you to track down bottlenecks and to see, do I have some limitations in the performance of the battery? And then you can adjust the microstructure to resolve the bottlenecks. Then this is something I already showed. Then I just end with the validation. And you might think about why do I need a validated model? So the validated model will put your simulations on a solid fundament. Here, this famous tower in Pisa, that fundament was not so solid, so the tower was tilting. But when you have a validated model, then the simulation is on a solid rock, like in these castles that are constructed on rock, and then they last for centuries. And yeah, so just a short reminder, validation is not the same as verification. Verification is more that the model is implemented correctly. Validation, you check, do we consider all important physical properties? Is the model fitting to the experimental data? And yes, this is the input or the workflow you need for the validation. You need the input parameters, that is the 3D scan, the material parameters you measured. Then you need some parameter fitting for the parameters that you cannot measure very precisely or only indirectly. Then you need to fit some parameters. And like fine tuning is applying the concentration dependence of the parameters. And for an example, I want to show you this validation for a graphite electrode in a half cell. We had a Structure E project going on with some partners in Germany, and they were doing lab experiments, like creating such graphite anodes in the lab. Then we had a scan, we segmented the scan, and they were measuring the potential curve of the graphite electrode and also all the different material properties that you need for the electrochemical simulation. And here in this table, you see all the different material parameters. And the green, you see there's a lot of different parameters. We have seen in the equations, there are a lot of material properties considered. The green ones are quite easy to measure, so these are not a problem. But you see some of the material parameters are marked yellow or red because they can only indirectly be measured, or are maybe concentration dependent, like diffusivity. And these are parameters you have to look at. Of course, you also have to make precise measurements for the other parameters, but then for the validation, you should focus on these more complicated parameters. And yeah, I just show you how this looked like in the experiment. So this is the potential curve of the graphite electrode against the lithium reservoir charged at 0.2C charging rate. This is the measured equilibrium potential. And yeah, the experiment was just going until a cutoff voltage of 0.01 volts. And now I was comparing GeoDict simulations with the experimental curve. And you can vary the parameters that we have seen before, where maybe a bit more important to have a look on. And this parameter variation, a very good method to do it, is the GeoDict cloud. So with the cloud, I could simulate in 2 hours the full simulation, and then you get the results for all the different parameter variations. And then you see here the effect of variation of the different parameters. So first is the diffusion. I always have the validated value in orange, and then I reduce it by 50% or increase it by like double or half of the value, or like one order of magnitude lower or higher. And then you see that there is some variation in the cell potential with the diffusivity. When you have a higher diffusivity, the cell potential goes up. Same I did for the Butler-Fermat rate constant, and it's the same relative change. So you do half of the Butler-Fermat rate constant, or 10 times less, or double Butler-Fermat rate constant, or 10 times more. And here you see that the effect of the Butler-Fermat rate constant is very strong. So it changes the the shape of the cell potential, and also the when the charging simulation stops, because for example, when you have 10 times less Butler Farmer weight constant, the cell didn't work at all. So it's very important that you do this adjustment of the Butler Farmer weight constant to that it fits to your experiments with such a parameter study. That's kind of the message from this slide. And then the other things, the Butler Farmer weight constant for the lithium reservoir is not so important. You see, it hardly changes the cell potential. And also the separator is just shifting the cell potential in y direction, but not changing the shape. So you have to think about it, but it's not so critical. And what you end up with is then this validated curve here that was with GeoDict 2023. So the final cell potential matched to the experiment. But you see here in the initial part of the simulation, there was still some deviation. And the reason for this is that actually the diffusivity of the graphite is concentration dependent. So when you do an experiment, you see at low concentration, you have high diffusivity. And when they measured at larger concentrations, there was a lower diffusivity. And with GeoDict 2024, you can now use this. There's instruction here if you want to see it. I will skip this now, the details, how you can use it. But you can download the instruction here. And then you see when you consider this concentration dependence, then also the initial part of the charging curve is fitting better to the experiment. Yeah, and that was already the summary for the validated model. And I'm at the end of the breakout session. After 2 hours, I hope it was interesting. So just to sum it up, also make use of GeoDict, be part of the people who already got to know how GeoDict can help them to make the batteries better. Always think about what model do I need? What is the optical model for the problem I want to solve? And if you manage to have a validated simulation, you can have a solid fundament for your data. Yeah, and it's quite complicated, but you are not alone. If you have questions, you can always write us, and then we have a projects team. And if you want to get something running with us, you can contact us. And yeah, so that was end of my talk. You can always write me if you have further questions. Yeah, we hear the people who are here. Of course, we can chat. Thank you very much for the attention.